We're going to read this morning from the second letter of Paul to Timothy and from chapter 4. And we're just going to read the last few verses. 2 Timothy 3. And we're going to read the last from verse 10 onwards. I'm reading from the New King James Version, although the Gideons used the NIV. I'm not sure what version you use here this morning. Let's hear the word of God. But you have carefully followed my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, love, perseverance, persecutions, afflictions, which happened to me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra, what persecutions I endured. And out of them all, the Lord delivered me. Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. But evil men and impostors will grow worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But you must continue in the things which you have learned and been assured of, knowing from whom you have learned them, and from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped in every good work. God will bless the reading of his word to us this morning. I just want to check the floor here to see where the trap door is, because Peter said you've got 30 minutes, and I want to do three things in the 30 minutes. I want to very briefly, just for 2 minutes, just give you a brief picture of the Gideon work. Then I want to turn to God's word, and then for the last 7 minutes, we're going to see a video clip which demonstrates the impact that the Gideon ministry is having in this day and age. Gideon ministry started in 1899 in America. Two men, traveling men, came together in a hotel and were bemoaning the fact that when they were away, there were no Bibles really available to them to study the Word of God. And so they covenanted that day to come back in a month's time, having prayed about it and to consider what might be done. And to cut a long story short, they came together, three of them on this occasion, and established what was then a traveler's ministry, a traveling salesman's ministry. And from that, the Gideon ministry has grown. And it came to Great Britain in 1949. The Cardiff branch was about the fourth branch, I believe, to be established. But since that time, God has truly blessed the work. There are now 300,000 strange people like myself, Christians, business professional men and their wives, who seek to serve God in 200 countries throughout the world. And last year, the Gideons alone distributed well over 92 million copies of God's Word. Not only the Bible, but the New Testament, and so on. And we praise God for that fact. In the UK here, GB, things in our secular society are becoming a little bit more difficult, as we well appreciate, and many doors are closing or have closed to us. But we continue to pray that God again might demonstrate his power and reopen them to us. Pontyclun, of course, is in the Glamorgan branch, and amongst the various places that they present God's word is in a Pant Comprehensive just down the road, where all year seven, or in my speak, 11-year-olds, are offered a copy of God's word. And it's a tremendous joy to know that the vast majority of young people, even today, will receive a copy of God's word. And we believe that that's so vital, because so few children today, young people, actually attend the house of God. So many of them are growing up in ignorance of the things of God. And God has blessed us as an organization by allowing us to go in and place copies of the Red Testament in their hands. And we pray that God will use it. Indeed, we know that God does use it. That's just the tip of an iceberg. Hospitals, hotels, homes for the elderly, wherever we're able to get into, the emergency services, the fire service, the police, the ambulance service, and so on. Recently, we've developed what we call badge testaments, and God has truly opened doors there in that virtually every member of the armed forces has received a copy of a testament with their own company insignia on it and with a prayer in it as well. And we know as a fact that so many of them have taken them to places like Afghanistan and so on, where God has continued to speak to them as individuals through them. And we're seeking to develop that particular work. So the work is developing tremendously, and we just value your prayers for it, and we pray that God may continue to bless us and encourage us as his people. That's the first thing. I hasten to add, I know, talking to Bill Capper, that the Biglamorgan branch have been here just several months ago, but they're very happy to come whenever you would like them to come to update you on the work here and across Great Britain and internationally. Just 6 years ago, I was privileged to go to Colombia in South America for 2 weeks as part of a team. And during that 2 weeks, we actually distributed 1.3 million copies of God's Word. We placed them in the hands of individuals. Contrary to what it's like over here, they were fighting each other to get hold of copies. What a tremendous difference in that land there. So please pray for the work. Secondly, the thing I need to do most of all this morning is just to spend time looking at God's Word. And I just want us to focus in on those two, for us as Gideons, certainly well-known verses. In verse 16 and 17, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for all good works. As we, as Gideons, and you as believers here this morning, would hold strongly to that verse that we read, we believe that it is the power of God, the word of God, unto salvation. And that is why God has sent it, that men and women, boys and girls, might be brought to a living faith in Jesus Christ. God's Holy Spirit, through the hearts and minds and hands of men of old, caused these words to be penned and to be brought together in the canon of Scripture and to be preserved over the years. But as we open the Word of God, God speaks to us through it. And I just want this morning just to take three headings. I know that that's what a good preacher is supposed to have, is three headings. I don't aspire to be a great preacher, but I've just got three headings that I want us just to focusing on just for a few moments this morning. The first one is that Scripture, all Scripture, we're told here, is inspired. You know, it's a great irony, isn't it, that when the annual bestsellers list come out, the Bible never features. And there's a reason for that. We look and we see people like J.K. Rowling at the top. They've sold umpteen million copies of their books over that particular year. But you know, there's a great reason for the Bible not featuring in it. because it was getting boring, because the Bible was always there at the top. I've just said that we as a Gideon organization alone last year distributed over 92 million copies of God's Word. And that takes no account of other organizations like the Bible Society and the great American voluntary organizations who are so much into distributing the Word of God. And therefore, the number of copies, despite what we might believe of God's Word being distributed across the world globally, is just phenomenal each and every year. And it's because of that that it no longer features in the book list, because it would always win. You know, there's a verse in 2 Peter 1, verse 21. It says, knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation, for prophecy never came by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. This underlines for us that this book that we have here is unique. It's different from all other books. And we believe that, I know, here this morning, because this book has been written by a divine author. There are no errors in it. There are no weaknesses in it. There are no contradictions in it. It is the inspired Word of God. Often, books have to be reprinted because on reading them, errors are found, errors of fact, typographical errors, whatever errors, and a new edition has to be brought out. But not so with the Word of God. The Word of God is inspired, it's infallible, but more than that, it's able to help each and every one of us with our daily lives. It's not unique, I don't think, to the Gideon Testament, but it's something that's often referred to us when we go to schools. There's a section in the front, where to find help when. And it deals with the different circumstances of life. I often say to the kids in school, you've got exams coming up. Are you worried about them? And often they'll say yes. And I'm able to point out a verse there. I then go on to say, how many of you are getting married? And they all chuckle and all that. But every element of life is covered by God in His Word and is there to help us. But it's reliable because it is inspired. You know, in this increasingly secular age, Christians, Christian things, the Christian lifestyles, particularly in this nation of ours, the Word of God comes under attack. But you know, praise God, because it is inspired, because it is God-breathed, is to take the exact meaning, if you like, of the original Greek. It doesn't affect its standing, whatever. It is still the power of God unto salvation. And you know, that's a great motivator for us as Gideons. It's what drives us on to distribute God's Word. So first of all, we're talking about an inspired, unique book, piece of literature, if you like, but it's God-given, and it applies to each and every individual, whether we accept it or not. But secondly, we also read here that the Scripture that we have is useful, it's profitable. And there are a number of couplets here that we read of. It's profitable for doctrine, teaching, if you like. Each one of us has been to school. Each one of us has been taught. We may not have enjoyed the experience. Some here are probably our teachers. And that's your occupation. And you seek to teach young people, children, about life and about things like that. The Bible is unique in that being infallible, it's able to teach us not only about God, but also the way that we should lead our lives. It was good to join in worship here this morning, to praise God in song for all that he has done for us through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, all that he does for us by the power of his Holy Spirit every day. But often I go to churches in holiday, and that's all their service amounts to, is just worship, praising God in singing. The word, the teaching, the proclamation of the word of God seems to have been relegated to almost non-existence. Praise God, that's not the case here, where the word of God is so central to the life of this church. It's here to allow us to understand why we're here, what God is, who God is, why we're here, how we should lead our lives day by day. But the other part of the couplet is not only doctrine, but it's here for reproof. We don't like being reproved. We don't like being shown that we're wrong. Well, if you're like me, you don't. But it's a reality of life. We're not perfect, far from it. We're sinners, but sinners saved by grace. But life is so difficult on occasions. But the Word of God clearly shows us those things in our lives as God's people which are wrong. And God, through his Word, highlights them. He reproves us for them. He shows us the way that we as God's people ought to live. God calls us as God's people to be distinctive, different from those around. It's a hallmark, if you like, of the transformation that has taken in our place in our lives, that we are different from the people around. And therefore, God's word, as it were, shines a light on our life, and in doing so, reproves us for those things which are not pleasing to God. But more than that, we find another couplet. It corrects us, or as in the original Greek, straightens us out, gets our lives back to where they ought to be. You know, that tells us and speaks to us, doesn't it, of that moment in your life and in my life when Jesus Christ became real to us. For me, it was the age of 12 in a church in Cardiff where the minister at the time was preaching about the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. He'd been preaching through the book of Revelation for some 18 months. And as a 12-year-old, most of it had gone intellectually over my head. But I remember one night, 12th of August, he ended his sermon by saying, "If the Lord Christ was to return tonight, where would you be?" And as a 12-year-old sitting up in the balcony, Christian parents, Christian grandparents, I knew in my own life that I was lost. And that night I came to know Christ as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm a member of the Gideon National Cabinet, and on Friday we had a meeting in Lutterworth, our headquarters, and this man, Andy, came along, and I'll just briefly read. In August 2006, while in prison — he was in prison because he had murdered an individual — I decided to make my own life. My situation had become so hopeless, I'd lost the will to live. I sat in my cell down in the segregation unit, waiting for the day shift to change over to their nighttime colleagues. It would be then I would put the noose I had made around my neck, fix it up at the window, then let myself hang to death. No more pain, no more shame. Relief from the awful situation I was in. At that moment, a quiet voice spoke to me. Just read that Bible. On the shelf sat a copy of the New Testament and Psalms placed by the Gideons. My mind answered immediately, "What good is that going to do for me?" Again the voice replied, "Just read the Bible." I opened the book at the beginning, Matthew's Gospel, and started to read it. At Luke's Gospel, it happened, the parable of the lost son. During this parable, my tears started to flow. My hopelessness disappeared. The wretchedness I had suffered went also. And most of all, the idea that I was unworthy of forgiveness was taken from me. Come Sunday in the prison chapel, I went to the front and gave my life to Christ. That was simply through reading the Word of God. God highlighted in his life the sin that he knew so well, and there straightened him out and brought him to a living faith. But it also helps us as God's people to correct those things that we know are wrong in our own life. And then, quickly moving on, it instructs us in righteousness. We've got a word for that in theological terms, and we sanctification. Through reading God's word as his people, God enables us to become more and more like him. Day by day, our lives are being transformed, or they ought to be being transformed, more into the likeness of God. The sins that we commit ought, we're never going to be perfect, but ought to be getting less and less. And yet, ironically, as we grow in grace, so more conscious we are of our own sins. We never fully attain it because we are only human individuals. But God's purpose for us as his people is that as we study his word, as we seek to imbibe it within us, that enables us to grow more righteous, more like him day by day. And then thirdly and finally, Scripture equips us. How does it do it? It equips us for every good work. That we're equipped as God's people for every good work. I don't know what your reputation is in the circles in which you spend your time during the course of the week. But I wonder if people, first of all, recognize that you and I are Christians. It's so easy in this society to hide our faith under a bushel, to use the scriptural language. But I wonder if we are distinctive from those around. But also, do people see in us something which is winsome? Are we being equipped for every good work? Are we the first there to help and to assist when people have difficulties, problems in their lives? Are we the individual who draws near to them and helps them? You know, we've got a young man in our church. He's been with us now for 5 years, Dan. And it's been a tremendous joy to see him grow in grace. He is faithful in studying the work of God. And from an individual who was far away from God, broken home, his life was an absolute mess. He now leads Bible studies in the church. And God has clearly worked in his heart in a tremendous way, that he has got a desire that men and women might know Jesus Christ as his Lord. Just looking at Dan, knowing Dan, over those 5 years, he stands out as somebody who God has equipped for every good work. This morning, as we draw to a close, just before seeing the brief video clip, I wonder this morning, is the word of God precious to you and me? Or is it something that we simply bring with us maybe on a Sunday, or perhaps we don't even bring a copy of God's word with us on a Sunday? But yet, Sunday is the only day in which we refer to it or even consider it. Or is it something which daily we seek to spend time in, praying that God might illumine its words to each one of our hearts, that God might use it in our lives, that God might guide us and direct us, but also that God might use us to help us to grow in grace and in his likeness. Oh, I pray this morning, as I pray for myself, that this might be your experience too. And this morning, if all I've been saying has been alien to you, it may be that you have never known what it is for your life to be transformed, for your sins to be forgiven, for the guilt that you feel to be removed, then this morning, come and read the Word of God. Come and hear what Christ says to you through the Word of God, and God will gloriously bring you to a living faith and trust in him. Could we show the video clip, please?
Every hour of the day, every day of the year, in nearly 200 countries, members of the Gideons International seek to win the lost for Christ as they place and present God's Word.
My family didn't have any connection with church or God or faith or anything like that. First started thinking about God and religion was through school. There was a special assembly on, and if we wanted to, we could choose to go to that assembly. There was somebody there from the Gideons, which I'd never heard of, never come across before. There was some sniggering, but he wasn't fazed by that at all. He talked about what the Bible meant for him. He just said, if anybody would like to have one of our Bibles, we'll gladly give you one. You can take it away, and I'd encourage you to read it. What was to lose from taking away one of these little red books? I was a bit embarrassed about having a Bible, that there wasn't one in the house. I didn't tell my parents, and I saw at the front there was a little space where you write your name, so I wrote my name in the Bible, and I found the reading plan. I'd read it when I went to bed, and I wouldn't put the light on because I was worried that my parents would see the light under the door. So I would read it by the light coming in from outside. I had a lamppost outside my bedroom window. My best friend at the time was a guy called Mike, and what I didn't know about him was that he went to church, and what he didn't know about me was that I was reading a New Testament. But then eventually it came out, and Mike invited me to a special event that they were having at their church. So on the Sunday morning, the preacher was speaking, and as he was speaking, I suppose the pennies started to drop. And at the end of the service, if anybody wanted to make a new start with God, they could commit their lives to Christ. I went forward, knelt down, and he led us in a prayer of commitment. And I look back at that time as the time when I made a definite decision to follow Christ.
As a young child of three, when my father left the home, when my parents divorced, it broke my heart. I became quite unhappy, and by the time I was 15 I was taking drugs and drinking a lot of alcohol, and I dropped out of school by the age of 25. Just really thought, what's the point of living? And I decided that I wanted to end my life. My mum lived up north and had a small hotel up there, and she said I could stay in one of the rooms there. I stopped off on the way to see my brother and his wife. My sister-in-law began to tell me about Jesus. There was a little conflict going on in my head, you know, what if this is real? What if it isn't? What if it is? So I said to my sister-in-law, what do I do? She said, we just pray. So that's when I got down on my hands and knees and I prayed and I asked him to forgive me. All I can say is that I was filled with hope. I left her home to go up north to stay at my mum's hotel, and I ended up in this hotel room, and I sat there and I saw a Bible. At the beginning of each Bible that's placed by the Gideons, there's helps in every situation or any circumstance that you're going through. As I was reading the Bible, God led me to scriptures that he knew that I needed. It was as if God was just sat there next to me on the bed, speaking words of love and peace straight into my heart. if that Bible hadn't have been there in that hotel room, I don't really know whether I'd be here now.
I was the only kid in my class that didn't have a real mum and dad at home. And when I discovered that, I was so worried. And my way of dealing with that trouble, that anxiety, was to make some bad choices. By the time I was 17, I'd been arrested and found myself on remand in Dorchester prison. I thought to myself, what have I done with my life? I'd filled my life with darkness. And I felt the only escape was to kill myself. So I made a rope out of a sheet on the bed. And it was at that point of trying to commit suicide, at the very verge of leaning forward, it felt like an invisible hand reached out of nowhere, gently yet firmly, pushing me back against the wall, taking the noose off around my neck and lowering me slowly yet gently to the floor. I didn't know it then, but a group of Christians from a Baptist church in Bournemouth had been praying about me. They'd read my case in the paper. They dared to believe that God could hear and answer their prayers. I was put into a cell on my own, and there I was locked up for 23 hours a day. I had nothing to do. I was bored out of my head. And then on the floor, I saw a book. I picked it up out of boredom, and it turned out to be a Gideon Bible. And I began to read the gospel. I read that there was a God in heaven that loved me. I got on my knees and I cried out to God. Christ came into my heart. I was locked up inside a prison, and yet I was the freest person in that prison. It was fantastic. Jesus has made the difference.
Members of the Gideons International place over 85 million Bibles a year in schools, colleges, universities, hotels, hospitals, prisons, armed forces, uniformed services, and many other areas of everyday life.
Here's a scary thought. What would have happened if I hadn't read the Bible? What would have happened if the Gideons hadn't placed a Bible in my prison? What would have happened if people hadn't prayed for the work of the Gideons, maybe given finance to purchase scriptures to put inside prison?
It was only because someone from the Gideons came into my school and gave me a New Testament that I started to read it, and it was through that that I found faith in Christ.
I was just very grateful that that Bible was there when I needed a Bible.
The prison officers said that I would die inside prison, that I'd be buried within the prison walls. That was my lot. That was my destiny. And yet I read the pages of a Bible and everything changed.
That's about a year old now, but nonetheless, it highlights graphically, I believe, the impact that God's word is having today across the globe. Someone said to me the other day that they believe that there are now 100 million Christians in China, and it will be our joy to go in there shortly, we believe, to begin distributing God's word. So let's give thanks to God for all he's doing. Not only through the Gideon ministry, but even through fellowships like your own, that men and women are coming to a saving faith in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Let's just pray. Father, we thank you for this opportunity this morning to just highlight the work of the Gideons, the work of distributing your precious word. But our Father, we take no thanks for doing so, but our Father, we rely completely and utterly upon you, because it is your word. It is your Holy Spirit that touches the hearts and lives of men and women and young people, even today, and brings them first into a living faith of Jesus Christ, and then brings them through to lead lives which are pleasing to you. Continue to bless this work as you bless this fellowship, we pray, because we ask it in Christ's name. Amen.